Thanks for joining us on Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. A Financial Times writer once wrote that our guest today, Ermonella Yahoo, is a singer who throws heart and soul into her singing. Don't even try to resist it. Well said. Ermonella, it's great to have you with us. Thank you for stopping by.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
You just finished a very successful run at the Met with your most sung role or not, the Cho-Cho-San in Butterfly. Is it the role you've sung the most?
Actually, the role that I've sung so far, it's Traviata, but Butterfly is another one, so yeah.
How was the run at the Met of Butterfly?
It was really a good experience. You know, I was back after 10 years because I sung at the Met. It was just one show. It was a jumping at the last moment, Violetta, with Jonas Kaufmann. I don't remember the whole cast because it was only like the last moment. And after that, I was so busy in Europe and we didn't find exactly the moment. So I came back after 10 years to sing Madame Butterfly, another dramatic.
Very dramatic. And probably good timing to come back after 10 years and sing something that important.
Yes, and it was different because I made my experience also, and I've sung Butterfly almost 100 times before singing at the Met. So all this journey, you know, singing this role so demanding, it helped me to feel more secure, let's say, you know, in this big stage, you know, with this audience, which they are waiting, you know, from the first to the last note. But it was a great experience, and I had the chance to sing with Maria Zivchak, which she was
Suzuki.
My first Suzuki 10 years ago in Philadelphia when I made my debut as Madame Butterfly. So singing between friends, it's so beautiful because we are singing the feelings, human feelings. And when you have this kind of connection, that complicity with the colleagues, and it's beautiful because that's why the public is waiting for, you know.
I'm sure. I wonder how many performances of Suzuki Maria has done, probably more than anyone in the world.
Absolutely.
She's so good in it. When you walk on that big stage at the Met, is it different for you? Do you have a different feeling singing, or does it feel comfortable?
It felt comfortable. To be honest with you, actually, this revival of Butterfly, I went for the premiere without having a rehearsal on stage or with the orchestra. And in the beginning, just to adjust a little bit because, you know, meanwhile, in this 10 years, you know, after Traviata, I've sung everywhere. So you need that kind of feedback on stage. And so it was a little just difficult, you know, to settle and to the first notes, let's say. And after that, everything, it was comfortable because I don't think about the opera house, how big it is, if my voice is going to be enough, but just you feel your guts. And just
go with it.
Go with it and give your heart and singing your soul, your heart out, because the public is waiting for that. Even if you have the most beautiful voice in the world, the biggest voice in the world, I think the public needs, you know, the voice. It's that kind of bridge, you know, which connects the hearts from the artist to the public. So I thought in that way, and I thought, okay, just leave your heart singing and let's see at the end.
So what was the reaction of yours when you jump in for the last moment?
For the Traviata.
Yeah. For Traviata. Well, I didn't have time to think about that, to be honest. And of course, for we are talking about 10 years ago, and for every singer, you know, to sing at the Met is something unbelievable. Sure. You know, in our head, in our mind, it's like, you know, you are like a princess going to this beautiful castle. You know, you feel it's a dream, you know. And but once I was there, I didn't have time to think about that. So just I was focused. And I told to myself, that's my opportunity. It's one shot. So right. just go, you know, and sing, you know, from your heart. And but it helped me very much in that period, because even if it's a jumping, you have to be prepared.
Sure.
You know, so but Traviata, I've sung many, many times also. So I was prepared musically, vocally. And but still, when you are on stage, it's like your first and last time of your life, because in that moment, that's the unique moment, you know, that you're singing in that night. So
what about when you finish that moment afterwards?
Oh God, I don't know. It was a release. Like I told myself, oh my God, I felt, you know, I felt like thinner because so much tension, and I felt like, you know, I lost so much weight there. But at the end, yes, when you see that kind of feedback that the public is applauding you. And they got you, you gave that kind of emotion, because sometimes we think, yes, I'm going on stage, I'm going to give that and that.
Right,
and
right.
talking, it's free, you know. But the singers, they have to speak through their work on stage, you know. Right. And until the last moment, yes, I was worried, because I thought, is my emotion going, you know, to the public, or it's like... In my mind, I'm dreaming, you know, doing that and that. But at the end, when you see that kind of feedback, it feels good. That
do you think that really opened up something for you?
I think so, but every time is different, you know. Every time is different, because it's a different public. We are different every day. We are a day, I call that a day older, because every day we are discovering new things. Like life every day, even the opera is like that, because the life experience, you know, makes you richer as a human being. But going through those opportunities, those difficult moments, you know, it's going to jumping there and there to be ready for that moment, it makes you feel, you know, a better musician also, because you are challenging yourself and you go a little bit out of your comfort zone. You know, and discover so many, many things. And yes, I think it helped me. It opened me, you know, another door. But you see that, you know, in time. And every time when I'm on stage, every time it's a life experience with colleagues, and I feel even the energy from the public, and it brings me another dimension, and where everything is human, pure human.
That's
feelings.
Right. Yeah. Seems to me that. The role you sing, it's always kind of drama.
Yeah, maybe because I'm coming from Albania, Balkan, the Balkan story, everything, the drama, the tragedy is there. But yeah, everyone has that inside, I think.
And, very intense.
Very intense, yeah.
Is that what you really enjoy?
Yes, because, you know, we are surrounded by the dramatic stories. Life is like that.
Yeah.
It's a life journey. Certain things may be... we lived for, or certain things we see, you know, around us, and everything is like, we are like an archive, you know, experience, life archive, and you put everything inside it. We are like sponge, and I was lucky because through the music, you know, I found my way to channel all my feelings. I was really a timid child, even in a country with so... a lot of history, a lot of many problems, like every country. And somehow I kept inside, and the only way when I felt free, really my soul was free, because no one could judge me because I came from Albania, or that, you know, how is life sometimes. Now it sounds maybe not so important, but it signs you. And singing for me, maybe hiding behind, you know, Traviata, Violetta, or Cecco San, or Sor Angelica, or... it somehow is a part of my soul is coming out through the singing. It was like a therapy. When I discovered that, it was an epiphany, because I realized that, you know, later when you are young, right, it's like the joy to be on stage. But step by step, you understand that it's a necessity that we have. And it became a therapy for me. And for me, every time I'm on stage, it's like I want to give everything. It's like, you know, maybe this is my last time. Right. And maybe sometimes it's not smart, let's say, as a singer, because, oh my God, you have to pace yourself, because, no, I discovered that the public needs emotion. We are singing emotion. And to be true, you know, if it's something that it makes you cry, you have to cry and sing at the same time.
You have to let yourself go.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And that's the key. When I discovered that, that's the key that I'm trying, you know, to improve technically, to have that kind of skill, you know, technically speaking, to let my heart, you know, free on stage, even if I have to scream, to cry, to laugh and everything, because you are more believable.
How did you start?
Oh, how I started. I was 14 years old. And actually, when I was a child, I wanted to sing, but pop music, because I didn't have an opera knowledge, let's say, you know, and like a young girl, you know, seeing, you know, the pop singers, and you want to be like them, you know, famous, and it started like that. But step by step, I wanted to be professional, you know, sing not only just, you know, you listen to the song and just sing after. And we have in Albania this conservatoire. And you need to have to win this competition, let's say, right, you know, the audition to get there and
to get in.
Exactly. And one of the things that I had to do, it was, you know, to sing something in one romanza in classical way. So I thought, okay, let's see. And they told me, no, this is opera, so you have to sing something, you know, in this way. Okay. And I went the first time when I was 14 years old in Tirana, the only opera house that we have there, the small opera house. And that night it was Traviata. And I didn't have a clue about Traviata, what was opera about. And I thought, okay. And I remember from the first sound of the overture, I fall in love immediately. It was something I can't find the words now to say. It was that, but something, it started from my inside. And I told my older brother, because I went with him, I told him, as a Balkan girl, talked to him. Now I decided what I want to be in the future. I want to be an opera singer, and I'm not going to die if I don't sing once in my life Traviata. And
what did he say?
And he said, okay, you know, because, you know, sometimes you dream about that. Right. But when you love something so much, and right, not only the idea, it starts with an idea, but when you want that so much, and I discovered it was the freedom of my soul. Oh, my God, I was chasing, and it was really a difficult journey. But when I think now, every time I'm on stage, when I think about my past, how hard it was to reach this point, that's why I feel now this is my moment. Maybe this is the last one. And in virtue of all what I had to go through, it's like this whole experience. Now this is my moment, and go for that.
Probably is a, you know, bittersweet. You know, you go through all that difficulty, and you reach your goal.
Are you
from a music family?
No, not a music family. But yes, it was hard. But I think now I understand. In the beginning, because I left Albania, I went in Italy to study. It was hard because I had this big dream. But financially, really, I had to start from scratch, you know, to do little works and jobs, you know, to survive.
What did your parents think about this idea of yours of singing?
My parents to be honest with you, they wanted me to feel, to be a normal child, to have my dreams. And yes, they supported me when I was in Albania. And after that, when I left Albania, I told them, now this is my destiny. And somehow I didn't tell to my parents all the difficulties that I had in Italy. So I told them everything is okay, everything is great, because it was my choice. And as all the parents, they feel sometimes guilty if they listen that their children are in difficulties, you know. And I knew they couldn't do more than that. So I didn't say a word to them how difficult it was for me, that journey. But I had my moments when I thought to myself, first of all, I was so sad because I thought, why I'm not a teenager like the other, teenagers, you know? Why I have to suffer that and that and that? But now, being a little, you know, with distance and in this position, I understand it was part of my journey. I had to, because an artist, to give emotion on stage, I think, not a tormented soul, but an experienced soul, it's really something, it's a treasure for an artist to give that kind of drama, nostalgia of that human feelings that we are talking about on stage. So in somehow I'm hiding behind all those roles, but I find a lot of myself behind. So it was worth it, all that journey, you know.
How did it come about that you were able to go to Italy to study?
I was dreaming, okay, about the La Scala, or, you know, and but the possibility, that the opportunity that I had, it was when Katia Ricciarelli came in Albania, in Tirana. It was the first or the second year that Albania was opened after the communism, you know. And I tried. I thought, okay, let's see this audition, if it's going to work or not. And I won. So it started like that, you know. And I told to myself, maybe it was a destiny. Sometimes when you want something so badly, with all your heart, because it's a necessity that you have, even the universe works towards that, you know, to make that realize, I think. So, yeah, in that way. And when I went to Italy, I started to learn the language, opera italiana. So, which
where did you go in Italy first?
First, Mantova. And after that, in Rome. I finished the Accademia of Santa Cecilia in Rome. And I started with some competitions. I couldn't pay the
entrance fee or the.
No, I couldn't pay sometimes, you know, to be part, to participate to certain competitions, even to pay a train tickets or a flight tickets, because, you know, I was doing, I was working as a babysitter or waitress, you know, just to make my living and, you know, to make it possible to stay there and to get this kind of culture from the Italian opera. So, yeah.
Maybe the difficult journey make you want even more.
Absolutely. It's like it was like, you know, a test.
That's right.
Life is a test.
That's right.
Because we like to say, my dream is that. I want to be like that. I want to reach that point. But when you have your face, the reality, and you see, okay, it's so hard. Maybe I need to go back, you know, and to see something, because it's so hard. No, for me, it was a test. I had moments really with a lot of depression also, because I was alone. I didn't want to say a word because it was my choice. I couldn't say. I saw my parents suffering, you know, that period in Albania, you know, the communism and all that situation like every country had. And I didn't want, you know, to add to them, you know, my problems. And in somehow, it was a test for me. Yes, you can say, okay, a teenager could have another life, you know. But no, it was a test for my about my dream also. And I wanted that desperately. Because this is a journey, a really difficult journey, you know, to make it work in the business, music business, because you have so much rejections.
Sure.
Not everyone likes you.
Sure.
Okay? So, and when you feel rejected and you feel, I'm not good enough.
How do you deal with that?
It was hard. 2-3 times I had the temptation to quit, but didn't last more than 24 hours because I was anxious. It was something that I was missing, you know? And I told to myself, yes, maybe something. I have to work hard. And I told, it was in my mind, really, if I love it so much, it's my liberty, my freedom, the freedom of my soul, I have to find the key to show to the public, to the other people, you know, that really is something, you know, important to me, and to make it work, to be able to show that through my singing, because you can have a lot of dreams, but if you don't work hard and to make that, you know, happen, and and always I started 2-3 times from the beginning, you know, and I told to myself, yes, maybe not everyone is going to like your singing, but be so good and improve yourself every day, and will come a moment they will accept you. And it happened like that. Of course, I can't pretend that everyone will love me, because everyone has their own taste. And but at least I'm happy that that kind of the language of my soul, I try to give that on stage with honesty and with my limits, because everyone has, you know, no one is perfect. But I think that kind of vulnerability is the key that created this love between me and the public. So still I'm working hard, because every day the body changes, and the muscles, how we project and we work or technically with the voice. But I discover new things, and always I'm searching, not for the perfection, because I know I'm not going to be perfect, never. But to express that vulnerability, that life experience, you know, having a good technique just to give me the liberty to express that, to give more and more and more on stage. So it helped, the difficult time, it helped so much.
You're doing so well on stage with those very intense roles. Maybe the family backgrounds, you know, you talking about the difficulty about your parents, your life there, that kind of give you the training.
Absolutely.
To be
absolutely
the place
absolutely
where you are.
Absolutely. And sometimes when I'm on stage, when you lose control, which is beautiful, because you go in another dimension. Especially it happened to me with Traviata, Suor Angelica. Like, I don't know, you don't feel anymore the ground. It feels like your soul is lifted. It feels like, you know, maybe sounds crazy, like in other life I was Angelica or a Violetta, because even if I repeat that 100 times, still, it's a pain, or it's something that it's not routine. Even if you sing that, for example, Traviata, I've sung so far 240 times, but still, every time I'm on stage is something different, because we are different every day. Yes, certain things that when I made my debut with Violetta, it was around 17, 18 years old. It was an experiment, just because the desire that I had to sing, you know? And to compare that moment with Traviata that I sing now, yes, I don't give so much like, you know, a teenager wants to give. I'm pacing myself, but sometimes that silence, that it's life experience. I'm highlighting the most important things sometimes for me, you know, in this moment of my life. And so like every day we are alive. Every day we discover new things. Even for the opera, it's the same. So
when you're on stage, when sometimes you might lose control of it, and does that affect your singing? Of course, I don't think that's that important, right?
But if sometimes it affects my singing, but still, yes, I'm losing control, but still it's that tiny, tiny thought that I have to go until the last note. So I have to make, that's my duty to be a professional, you know? But compromise certain, sometimes when you have certain notes, you know, and it's written parlando, talking, you know, in certain scores. And there is desperation. And I'm not singing parlando. I'm screaming, of course, screaming. It's going to give you that sound. But if you are real, you believe in what you're singing, the public is not going to think, oh my God, something wrong with her voice. It's a voice crying, screaming, because you are playing that personage, that moment, life moment there. So, and I think it's more believable, you know. Yes, of course, it's the stress for the vocal cords, but no one is going to live forever. Okay. I'm not going to sing forever.
I think you can connect with the audience that way.
Yeah. For example, like in Suor Angelica, when Tia Principessa de Ant is saying to her, your child is dead, you know, when it was seven years that she didn't see her child. And I remember in that moment, it's not written, you can do, but I was crying my soul out. Like, because in that moment, it was that loss that I had, you know, it was that period when I made my debut as Angelica. I lost my parents, my mother, my father. And then somehow, to be a Balkan, we react, like, you know, because it's a part of our tradition. And I was numb. And that's the therapy sometimes, the music. When I was on stage, that kind of screaming, crying, it came out. And after that, you have Senza Mama with the pianissimo. Mm. You needed the control. And I don't know, maybe in that moment when I started to sing Senza Mama after that crying and screaming, it was everything there, but it was a sound, a desperate sound, but it was there. And I told to myself, wow, sometimes, yeah, it's better to let it go. Yes, it's gonna feel a little crack in your voice, but if you are crying for your loss, because you lost your child, your parents, or in that moment in life, we don't think how my voice is going to sound now. Your soul cries out.
And Manella, we'll come back to this. We want to talk more about this. But unfortunately, we need to take a break.
Sure.
We're here at Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today, we're having the great pleasure of speaking to Manella Yahoo.